Well, welcome, one and all. We're delighted to have you with us for this rather impromptu marking, I should say. I was going to say celebration, but that's certainly not the right word for it. Marking, commemorating, bemoaning an anniversary that will take place tomorrow, the 80th anniversary, to be specific, of a very black day. One of our speakers has correctly described it as a day that should live in infamy, the day on which the United States government, for the first time, normalized relations with what was then known as the Soviet Union. We're going to talk a bit about the circumstances under which that normalization took place, and of course, what flowed from it, with a panel of extraordinary experts on the subject, authors, practitioners of the business of recognizing and countering totalitarian ideologies bent on our destruction, as they have sought, as they seem inevitably to do, to destroy us from within. We're going to talk about this in both the historical context of what happened on November 16th, 1933, what undertakings were made in that event, and what flowed from it, both in the years that immediately followed and really right up to the present moment, at the hands of both the communists and their fellow travelers and the government of the United States. We're also going to talk about the predicate that it turned out that proved to be for what has happened in more recent times, as our government has addressed or interacted with, might be a better term for it, another totalitarian ideology, also committed to our destruction, also engaged in the business of trying to destroy us from within. I'll introduce each of our speakers in turn, but let me just say how utterly thrilled I am that we were able, on very short notice, to put together a group of this caliber to mark this occasion. I will tell you that I wouldn't have known this occasion was at hand, but for our first speaker, Diana West. I have the privilege of interviewing Diana just about every week on our radio program, Secure Freedom Radio, and it is truly one of the high points of the week. In the course of it, we've talked both before the publication and subsequent to the publication of her marvelous new book, American Betrayal, The Secret Assault on the Nation's Character, Our Nation's Character, about the events that that took place 80 years ago tomorrow. And there's simply nobody better, I think, than she to introduce to us what happened on that occasion and what has flowed from it, as she has chronicled in her, as I say, very carefully documented and riveting account of the betrayal of our country. We'll hear next from M. Stanton Evans, a man who has also authored pioneering books on the subject of what happened during this period at the hands of the communists and at the hands of our own government. Most recently, he's written about McCarthy. Actually, is that most recent? Probably not most recent. The book with Romerstein is more recent. But suffice it to say, on all accounts, he is an authority on these subjects, and I'm looking forward to having him talk about particularly what happened during the Cold War period as the subversive aspects of Soviet communism began to be exposed and then concealed. We'll hear from Chris Farrell, who works right here at Judicial Watch, and I should have said at the outset how Grateful I am that we were able to make use of this wonderful facility. Chris, thank you to you and to Tom Fitton for making it available and for participating as well. Chris is a practitioner of the business of counterintelligence, having served as a military intelligence officer prior to joining Judicial Watch as its director of investigations and research. He does a remarkable job here in that capacity. And we're anxious to have him talk a bit about what it was like actually confronting and trying to operate against those who were running both intelligence operations and influence operations and other subversive activities in our country during the Cold War. He is also something of an authority on what has been happening in more recent times under the Islamists' successors of the communists. And he'll be joined in talking a bit about that, I hope, by one of the country's preeminent experts on that subject, our own Steve Coughlin, a senior fellow at the Center for Security Policy, an attorney, an intelligence officer in the United States Army Reserves, who for a time served as the duty expert on Islamism and Sharia and related topics for the Joint Chiefs of Staff. Until, unfortunately, he was purged from that position by those engaged in influence operations on behalf of this totalitarian ideology sworn to our destruction, and their representatives inside the senior-most offices of the Pentagon under the George W. Bush administration. So we'll get his take on how this practice is continuing to this day, and how the United States government is doing as it did starting 80 years ago, I guess, misleading the American people about the true nature of the threat, and in fact enabling it in very, very ominous ways. So with that, let me welcome Diana West, author, columnist, and fabulous talk show content supplier. Welcome, Diana.
Thank you very much, Frank, for that lovely introduction. And I'm so glad that people have come to mark this day. We shouldn't be alone with this 80th anniversary upon us tomorrow. If we think back 80 years, essentially the question that President Roosevelt then in his first term, his first year of his first term, put to his administration, or the concept that people were laboring under, was how do you normalize relations with an abnormal state? And that is a very important part of this thinking this through, how this all came about. Because the simplest answer, and the best way we can really explain it now, is the simplest answer is you have to pretend that it's normal. You have to pretend, you have to lie, when it comes to that, that you are actually having state-to-state relations that are just like any other state. Now, if we think back to 1933, we're looking at a time when the Soviet Union had only been in power 16 years. It was openly and aggressively revolutionary, and it was already known not to keep pledges that it made as a point of that open and revolutionary aggression. And there's something else that needs to be taken into account, and that is that the Soviet Union was already known to be a mass murderous regime, unlike anything in modern times. We had certainly Stalin's, Lenin's Red Terror and related massacres, exterminations in the 1920s, and then moving on to Stalin, what we're looking at in November of 1933 is something of a lull in what we now look back on as the Ukraine terror famine, when something like 5 or 6 million, or maybe more, people were starved to death by the government, by Stalin's government, state-engineered famine. Now that number, 6 million, of course, rings a bell. We know that number as the number of people that Hitler killed in the Holocaust. And yet, imagine if we scramble history a little bit, if the government decided to normalize relations with a Nazi regime that had just done this to 6 million of its own people, it wouldn't happen. It would be decried as a morally unconscionable act, as it would be. And yet, this dozen years later, this is something that the United States entered into. Now, Robert Conquest, who's the great chronicler of that famine, has demonstrated that this was widely known about. There were plenty of reports out in the Western world about the famine, what Stalin had done. And yet Stalin was able to sow sufficient doubt at the same time with this practice that we now look back on, and this is what Conquest says, as the first big lie, the first deception, mass deception, that was amplified around the world by then growing mass media. But there's no doubt that these facts were known by the diplomatic community in Moscow and by the press in Moscow. In fact, Eugene Lyons, who would become a former socialist later in the 30s, wrote about this period and said, you could be deaf, dumb, and blind and in a hotel room in Moscow and you would still know about this state-engineered famine. So with that as a backdrop, we have a dinner, a cabinet dinner at the White House on November 16th, a musicale, and at 11 p.m., a group of officials met with the president in his study. And this would have been the Undersecretary of State, William Phillips, who was against recognition but was carrying out the necessary negotiations. Then Secretary of the Treasury, Harry Wooden, Henry Morgenthau Jr., who would become FDR Secretary of the Treasury, ably assisted by Harry Dexter White later on, a noted Soviet agent, as I imagine Stanton Evans will be telling us. But then Morgenthau was head of the Farm Credit Administration, seeking new markets. And we also had William C. Bullitt, who was a very charming, well-educated American blue blood and Bolshevik at the time. Came from a very good family, as they used to say, related to Patrick Henry, also related French Huguenots, came over very early, also a very notable, apparently, German-Jewish family on his mother's side. He would become our first ambassador to the Soviet Union, very enthusiastic supporter and indeed one of the lead people in this negotiation. No Secretary of State Hull, however. He was the man who was never there, really, when these types of negotiations were underway. And William Phillips wrote about this, and he said, the president joined us at 11 o'clock and read the exchange of notes together with the various enclosures which had been agreed upon during the preceding days. Litvinov made a few objections. They were finally overcome. Although the documents were dated November 16th, actually the signing did not take place until 14 minutes past 1 o'clock on the morning of the 17th. The president was elated, and we all celebrated with quaffs of what was almost the last of Prohibition beer. And it was done. And several years later, we actually find out what happened after Foreign Minister Litvinov left the White House and walked, or probably drove, up a couple of blocks to the Russian embassy, then right up the street on 16th Street. He walked in and he said, well, it's all in the bag, and we got it. They discussed some of the obstacles, which included religious freedom. Apparently, this came up again at the conversation. And he said, I gave it to them, meaning the Americans. I gave Russia's religious freedom to the Americans, and I told them that there would be shipments of Bibles to the Soviet Union. And later on, when he was testifying about this in Congress, one of the congressmen asked him if this was amusing to Litvinov, and he replied, this was the witness said, he was very much amused at that because that was the culmination, evidently, of the simplicity of American officialdom. But not everyone was so simple, and if simple-minded really is what was going on, that's not a description of everyone. Some people were very knowing about what was to happen. The wife of the Undersecretary Phillips, Ella Phillips, wrote in her diary, we are only following the majority of other Christian countries, but in so doing, I feel we have lost our moral standing. It is sad and demoralizing when we lose our honor for expediency. Joseph Grew, who was a very fine American diplomat who spent many years in Japan, would later become acting Secretary of State, he echoed these reservations. He wrote that recognition of the Soviet Union constituted a serious sacrifice of principle and letting down of standards. The United States, he insisted, should never palliate by recognition the things Soviet Russia has done and the things it stands for. But that is exactly what recognition did. It palliated, it legitimized, and indeed, the Ukraine terror famine never came up in these negotiations. A couple of historians, not many, but have noted this as a measure of making the United States a passive accomplice to this crime. It's interesting to note that Bullitt's own uncle, well, Bullitt was the big booster of this, his uncle was an archdeacon at the time, James F. Bullitt. He made headlines too for saying that Bullitt's uncle says Soviet deal disgraces United States. And he called the Soviet Union a country beyond the pale and added, Russia will keep no promises with us. So there were a number of people aware of the nature of the Soviet Union, aware of what was going on, aware of how this type of pretend agreement relationship was doomed in terms of a normal relationship. Just to stick with Bullitt for a moment, he would change his mind. He would actually spend the next 20 months, he was ambassador in Moscow, our very first ambassador, and his experiences there led him to change his mind and to realize that this was not a possible relationship, that there would be no normal relationship here. And he actually became a very vocal opponent of the Soviet Union, having been someone that was described very often in the press as, you know, Bolshevik in tendency. But this made him very different from the other people in the administration, kind of a man out of his time in the sense of someone who could look at evidence and make a decision. What we're seeing here with recognition and with the kinds of people pushing this relationship is an insertion of ideology over evidence. And I think that's a very important point in American statecraft. Now, another man who was aware of this and would actually become very key in trying to expose its effects was Martin Dies. He was representative from Texas, and he was very shocked by recognition and conveyed this to the president. And in his memoir, which he wrote in the 60s, he wrote that he pointed out that the communist regime, again, this is 1933, was based on ruthless force and unspeakable crimes, that its barbarian ideology was opposed to religion, morality, decency, truthfulness, and the rights and dignity of man, which is about the Soviet Union in a nutshell. I stressed that recognition would give respectability to international gangsters and open the door for continued and expanded infiltration of America by foreign propagandists, revolutionaries, spies, and saboteurs. Of course, his protests were ignored. And the excuse given was, the president has a written agreement. The agreement was not worth the paper it was written on. And there would be no consequences for the pledges that were already being broken when they signed the papers. Indeed, one of the main points of agreement was that the Soviet Union would cease and desist in, or not engage in, attempts to overthrow our country, attempts to subvert our government, to change our political and social institutions. This was ongoing at the point of this exchange of notes recognition, and it would only increase. And this would be something that Martin Dies, a few years later, would investigate when he opened up, as founding chairman, the House Un-American Activities Committee in 1938. I think a lot of times when we look back at history, we think, oh, they just arbitrarily started investigating communism for no particular good reason. Well, that's not at all the case. This is what was happening due to recognition, this kind of infiltration. And when that committee opened, it was actually looking at fascism in this country. It was looking at all totalitarianism, including communism. The sticking point between Dies and the president, because they had been good friends, was his investigations of communism. And he tried very hard to dissuade him from making these investigations, and indeed it ruptured their relationship. The consequences of allowing the Soviets to break pledges on this level openly, which is something Ambassador Bullitt was writing home about, something that Martin Dies and others would be investigating in the 1930s and laying out evidence of, the decision to shut our eyes to it on an official level, for the White House to be able to ignore this and just keep going. It's part of the reason why Ronald Reagan came in the early 1980s and asked his team to evaluate 25 years worth of arms control treaties. They came back to him and said, basically, with the Soviet Union, of course, they came back to him and could not really find anything that had been adhered to. So this was the practice, and this was the state of the relationship. But what it did to us, I argue, and this is where I get into the secret assault on our nation's character in my book subtitle, we became transformed by this pretend, by these lies, by engaging in these lies, and indeed by forsaking evidence and testimony, truth, and also morality. This was a release of a moral compass. Now, I'll conclude by noting that Alexander Solzhenitsyn looked at these matters from the other side. And when he first came out of the Soviet Union, his very first speech in the United States was in 1975. He was not invited to the Ford White House, which is a disgrace, something I discuss. But he gave his first speech to the AFL-CIO. And one of the things he put in front of them was the double standard that the West had regarded first Tsarist Russia and then Soviet Russia with. And he pointed out that in the 80 years before the revolution, a time when a Tsar was assassinated, many attempts on the other Tsar's lives, revolutionary uprisings, the Tsarist government put to death 17 revolutionaries a year. This is the average for that. In the Spanish Inquisition, which we look back on as an epic bloodletting, we were at the height of it. We're looking at 10 persons a month. When we get to 1918, after the Russian Revolution, the Cheka, which the precursor to KGB and so on, was killing, without trial, more than 1,000 people a month. When we get into the 1930s, under Stalin and his purges, we're looking in excess of 40,000 a month. So Solzhenitsyn presents what I call this moral calculus of 17 a year, 10 a month, 1,000 a month, and 40,000 a month, asking us why the embrace of Soviet Russia. And it's a very valid question. It's a very good question. I don't know how people regarded it in the audience, but he did point out to them that when we get to alliance, because for him, 1933 with recognition and then 1941 with military alliance with Stalin, these were two unprincipled deals with totalitarianism, and he told his audiences this, he wrote about this, and he said, at the first threat of Hitlerism, you stretched out your hands to Stalin. You call that sustaining democracy? Hardly. Now he, in the 1940s, actually believed this was due to a lack of information that we didn't know, and one of his goals was to get to meet the Americans and tell them when he was a soldier. He actually hoped to get to Germany and talk to the Americans. He was arrested by Stalin and sent to the Gulag for 8 years instead. So what we're looking at is this period of time from recognition to alliance to periods of deeper complicity during the war, lying on behalf of Stalin, for example, in Katyn Forest Massacre, becoming more colluding with them in various other crimes against humanity, Operation Keelhaul, which Stanton Evans may be telling us about soon. The greatest betrayal of all, the POWs at the end of World War II that we left in Stalin's hands. And what I think to conclude with is that when we look back at the Communist Manifesto of 1848, one of the most fearful things about it was the rupture with traditional ideas, the abolition of eternal truths, morality, religion. And it suddenly struck me that this mechanism of recognition, in a sense, made that manifesto, made those elements of the manifesto manifest in our country. And thank you.
Thank you, Diana. I think I neglected in my excitement about this panel to introduce myself. I'm Frank Gaffney, the president of the Center for Security Policy.
Yeah.
We're happy to be hosting this. I also neglected to give you the full title of two of Stan's eight books, both of which bear directly on what we're going to ask him to speak about now. Blacklisted by History, The Untold Story of Senator Joe McCarthy, and Stalin's Secret Agents, The Subversion of Roosevelt's Government relations. Welcome, Stan Evans. Thank you.
Thank you, Frank. The presentation you just heard is an excellent summary of what indeed did happen in the run-up to recognition and the falsehoods of the Soviets at that time, which continued till the collapse of the Soviet Empire. But also, that recognition was enabled and aided by our own deceptions within our own society. And the leading example of this, Diane has alluded to the episode, was a man named Walter Duranty, who was the Moscow correspondent of the New York Times in Moscow at the time of the deadly famine that had been induced by Stalin as a matter of policy to starve out the peasants, to make them hand over their crops and their livestock and so on to the state. Sort of an early version of Obamacare. And equally enabled by the media. And the person who was doing this, most of all, was Duranty. Now, this is not to be confused for show business aficionados with Jimmy Duranty, who was a good guy, as far as I know. This is Walter Duranty, and he was the most famous journalist, probably, of his era, and certainly the most famous reporting on Russia. And Walter Duranty was reporting at the very height of the famine to which Diana has alluded, that there was really no famine, that this was all false propaganda. And again, to establish a little parallel to events today, this is from Stalin's secret agents, by the way, quote a dispatch that he sent back at the height of the famine, where between 5 and 10 million people were brutally exterminated. This is what Duranty wrote. Any report of famine in Russia today is an exaggeration or malicious propaganda. The food shortage, which has affected almost the whole population, has, however, caused heavy loss of life. Does this sound a little bit like, I apologize for any misunderstanding that may have resulted from anything that I said that you misunderstood that turned out not to be accurate? This statement I heard just this morning on the radio. In any event, that was the kind of reportage that was provided by Walter Duranty in 1933, for which he won the Pulitzer Prize. And when Maxim Litvinov came to the United States to close the deal that Diana has referred to, Duranty accompanied him on the journey. He was part of the traveling entourage of the Soviet ambassador. When the celebrations occurred about the recognition, which were many of the type Diana has described, the person who was most lauded and applauded at various pro-Soviet rallies was Franklin Roosevelt. The second most lauded and applauded was Walter Duranty. So the pattern that we have seen over the years of press obfuscation, press enabling, continued to this day, began really then and preceded that, but certainly in terms of the Soviet Union, was most clearly benchmarked in 1933. That has been the history of our involvement with the Soviets and the issue of communism in the Cold War ever since. The entire history that we have been given about this, and this has gotten Diana in a bit of trouble for pointing this out, and me also, I might add, on occasion, is that the history we have been given is bogus. It's phony. It is what I call court history, which is written to justify and glorify the people wielding power, principally Roosevelt and his aide Harry Hopkins, but then Truman and others who followed. Dinah's book and my book, Stalin's Secret Agents and the Blacklisted by History, are really efforts to break through this established narrative to get at the real history of this whole era. And there's no way to condense this into a 10-minute presentation, and I'm going to just have to give you the, what I wouldn't call them highlights, sort of lowlights. The first thing is that, as Dinah mentioned, the establishment of diplomatic relations did all kinds of things. It gave a legitimacy to the Soviet regime, which was killing its own people at that very moment. But also, it established right in this city an outpost of subversion, the Soviet embassy. Some of us were 2 weeks ago at the university club over in Northwest, and that's right next door to the Soviet embassy, now closed. They have a much bigger and better embassy. They did after that, but that embassy building is still there. That embassy was the hub for espionage, policy influence, manipulation of agents, and managing a whole network of people in the communist community who served the Soviet Union instead of the United States. The result of this, and then this accentuated in World War II, was the massive infiltration of our government by communists and Soviet agents. Something long understated, something long denied, something long ignored in the standard histories, and indeed is still ignored in many of them to this day. There are biographies of Roosevelt and of Truman in which the name of Harry Dexter White does not appear, even though he's probably the most important Soviet agent. It's hard to gauge the relative strengths of these people, but he certainly was among the top three. The top three Soviet agents in our government in this era were, of course, Alger Hiss, well-known case, a man named Laughlin Curry, who was a top aide to Roosevelt in the White House, and Harry Dexter White, who really was the mayor of the palace. He ran the Treasury Department under Henry Morgenthau Jr. And all of these people worked full time when they weren't shuffling bureaucratic papers to promote the interests of the Soviet Union and to subvert our allies and us. They were traitors in every sense of the word, and they were allowed into the government by this series of events that Dinah has described at its origin and which continued through the war. The result of this was that there were literally hundreds, and probably more than hundreds, of Soviet agents in our government by the early 1940s. And my books and Dinah's book address that fact. And there are other books that do so also. But the question becomes, therefore, and we've been at many forums where these issues are discussed, well, so what? You know, they were there, what were they doing? And there is a definite effort, even today, and this is the point that I think is most salient, to minimize this problem, even as the data showing it have come forth from Soviet archives and our own archives. I had the opportunity, and I wouldn't call it the pleasure, but the learning experience of going through about 100,000 pages of FBI files, which are available under the Freedom of Information Act. And there you can see over and over again the appearance of all, the names of all these alleged innocent victims who are in fact communists. They're in those files. And the FBI knew it at the time. It was all ignored, covered up, shoved under the rug, lied about, and even to this day is not fully acknowledged. What did they do? The answer is obscured by these minimization procedures, which focus strictly on the issue of spying. But spying is not the real issue. As Whitaker Chambers pointed out, as we point out, Herb Rubinstein and I, and Stalin's secret agents, spying was trivial as Whitaker Chambers put it, compared to the much larger issue of policy influence. What these people were doing, it's very successfully in many cases, was warping our policy in favor of the Soviet Union and other communist elements overseas, and doing so all over the world. Every quarter of the globe, this was happening. And we were then blind to, we meaning the non-communist community, were blind to this. And to the degree that it is now apparent to some of us, it is still being denied by others. It's been denied to this day. I have participated in many a discussion where they said, well, he didn't give them any documents, so therefore, let him go. He's free and clear. Not true. And I, in the book, in this book, Diana talks about a number of these episodes also. In our book, Stalin's Secret Agents, we have maybe a dozen of these episodes. Pearl Harbor, to give this as briefly as possible, was actually, Pearl Harbor per se was not caused by the Soviets. They did not know, I don't think, where the attack was going to be. But people such as Harry Dexter White and Lachlan Curry in the United States in 1941, and people such as Richard Sorge, who was a leading Soviet agent in Japan, and his assistants, Kinkazu Saonji and Hatsumi Ozaki, were two high-ranking Japanese who were communists. Owen Lattimore, who was in Chungking as advisor to Chiang Kai-shek. All of these people worked in a coordinated fashion to make sure that Japan, which is an historic enemy of the Soviet Union, did not attack Russia from the east while Hitler was attacking them from the west. And this was Stalin's great fear, that Russia would become embroiled in a two-front war. And the major objective of Sorge in Tokyo and White and Curry in the United States and others was to make sure that this did not happen. And the case of Joseph Grew is mentioned. Joseph Grew was then our ambassador to Tokyo. Joseph Grew and others, including General Marshall and others in our government here, wanted to work out a truce between Japan and the United States to prevent open warfare in the Pacific. Harry Dexter White and Lachlan Curry and Sorge in Tokyo and Owen Lattimore helping out from Chungking all labored to make sure that this did not happen, so that the blow that would be struck by the Japanese, and this is in the middle of a war that they'd already been involved with in China, and meanwhile Hitler is invading Russia from the west. This is 1941. To make sure that if the Japanese struck any blow, which they were poised to do, they would go south. They would not attack Russia. This is all very clear. In promoting this policy of fending off a truce between the United States and Japan, Harry Dexter White was in collusion with a KGB agent named Vitaly Pavlov, who wrote a memoir about this called Operation Snow in Russian, which has been translated. This is a play on White's name, Snow White. And in this memoir, Pavlov reveals that he met here in Washington early in 1941 with White. They met at the old Ebbett Grill. If you've not been to the old Ebbett Grill, I recommend it highly. Chili is very good. Right across the Treasury Department, very convenient for Harry Dexter White. And Pavlov gave White the talking points to follow to shoot down any idea of a truce between the United States and Japan, which White, in fact, did recite in opposing the truce successfully, and got these talking points included in the final document that Secretary Hull gave to the Japanese envoys on November 26, 1941. Well, this is less than 2 weeks before Pearl Harbor. That is one example. Believe me, these examples are infinite of policy influence. Now, this did not involve Henry Dexter White stealing a document or any of that kind of nonsense, although that's important too, but it is nowhere near as important as this influence on policy that White and Curry and Hiss wielded. And I could go on there. I'm going to cut this short. I do want to read to you one thing that we deal with in Solid Secret Agents about the Yalta Conference. I think most people here, this is a knowledgeable audience, know about Yalta, and that at Yalta, vast concessions were made to the Soviets, including confirming their control of Eastern Europe, but also giving them, in essence, control of China because of their takeover of Manchuria and the railroads and the ports, and because of other agreements that were made at Yalta to get them into the war against Japan, although they were in that war for 5 days before the Japanese announced surrender, for which they get control of the Far East after having done nothing for 4 years. But the histories of this would make you believe it was just all inevitable, nothing could be done about it. Well, the principal American who didn't know what he was doing about China and other things at Yalta was Alger Hiss. Now, the conventional histories tell us, one of Diana's great critics, a man named Conrad Black, has told us several times that Alger Hiss at Yalta was totally insignificant, that he was a mere clerk. He didn't know anything. He was a lowly, you know, munchkin. Totally false. But that's what's in all the conventional histories. And I want to, part of the research that I did for doing this book was about Yalta, which you've got to do. One thing I would say to everybody who's interested in this stuff, you can, I hate to say this because I write books, don't trust books. Most of them are recycled error and disinformation about all of this. All of it is, to me, bogus. In one way or another. It's been covered up. It is still covered up to a large extent. I went down to Charlottesville, Virginia, after some searching, to find the papers of a man named Edward Stettinius, Jr., who was the Secretary of State at the time of Yalta. And he had held that post at the time of Yalta for 2 months. 2 months. He was a very naive person. He knew almost nothing about foreign policy. He'd been Under Secretary of State for some time, but he really knew very little. And I go into in his book about how much he didn't know. And he was reliant on Hiss for knowledge of almost every issue. President Roosevelt at Yalta was virtually dead. I am convinced, the more I study this, that Roosevelt did not know half or two-thirds of Yalta. What was done there was all manipulated underneath that level. And this is the way a lot of things work in government, as we know. Bills that are passed that nobody's read. Who's writing these bills? And it's the same kind of thing in the Cold War. Alger Hiss was probably the American at Yalta who knew the most and did the most. And what I found in the Stettinius papers was a whole bunch of stuff that has never been reported by our standard historians glorifying Franklin Roosevelt. And what I'm going to read to you now, and then I'll be quiet, is from the notes of a man, of Stettinius, recorded by a man named Walter Johnson. Now, those of us from Washington know the name Walter Johnson. He's a great pitcher for the Washington Senators back in the 20s. This is a different Walter Johnson, who was a historian at the University of Chicago. And he helped Stettinius write his memoir of Yalta, which is called Roosevelt and the Russians. It was posthumously published in 1949. Stettinius died very young. In the archives of Edward Stettinius, I found the notes of Walter Johnson, where he's trying to question Stettinius about what happened at Yalta and who did what and so forth. And so he asked him a series of questions, and I'll do this very briefly if I can, about different topics that happened. This is in the notes in Charlottesville, Virginia, of Stettinius' papers. So he asked him about the signing of a German occupation zone to France, which was a controversial issue at Yalta. Stettinius told Johnson, quote, Alger Hiss can fill in the background. Then on further comment about the role of France, the former secretary said, see Alger Hiss about this. On the issue of forced German labor, which was part of Yalta, the conscripted slave labor as reparations to the Soviets was agreed to by us at Yalta, even though Stettinius didn't know it. He told Johnson it just didn't happen. Just happened on his watch, he didn't know about it. And on this issue, Stettinius said, see Alger, and we'll discuss this again. Further discussion of the German occupation. This is a major issue. Yalta, of course, February 1945, Germans surrendered in May. Hiss would remember, consult him. On the question of who drafted the Yalta Declaration of Liberated Europe, which is a repetition of the Atlantic Charter, basically. See Alger Hiss again. On voting arrangements for the UN. See Alger Hiss about this, and so forth, and so on. This is the record which is denied to this day. It's not something that was denied back then. It's denied right now. This is the history of what has gone on, and the whole thing's been mantled in deception and denial and refusal to face the truth, which reflects against the standard narrative. A lot more to say about it, but I'm going to stop right there. Thank you. Thank you.
Well done, Stan. Thank you. Now, from the perspective of someone who had to contend with some of these operations, some of the party line, if I can use that expression, that was operating to ignore them or conceal them, Chris Farrell.
Thank you, Frank. So I'm going to try to report to you from some of the warmer spots in the Cold War. And these warm spots were occupied by places and persons who were engaged in espionage and subversion, active measure campaigns, influence operations. And I'm going to quickly drag it up from the kind of the crest and then the fall of the communists at the end of the Cold War to today and some work we're doing here at Judicial Watch. So my background is I'm an Army intelligence officer. I was commissioned as one back in the early 80s and initially became a special agent in Army counterintelligence and then later a clandestine human intelligence case officer. My first encounter with communism, eyeball to eyeball, firsthand experience, was as a young lieutenant, as a border officer in Germany, at a place where the Third World War never happened, Fulda, where we sat in the Fulda Gap waiting to engage with the 8th Guards Tank Army and other folks, and it just never happened, thank goodness. But it was literally the place where the Iron Curtain was drawn across Germany. At that spot, and in one particular place, a place called Observation Post Alpha, or OP Alpha, or at least I could certainly appreciate and understand the intensity and the level of all that was poured into what became the Cold War, something for us that lasted, you know, let's say, from 45 onwards. And so here at this observation post, just as one anecdotal tidbit, the people from Rasdorf, Germany, which is the nearest little village, would march out every Christmas Eve and have a candlelight procession to OP Alpha. And when I got there for my very first tour of duty with the Armored Cavalry Regiment, I asked, you know, what's the deal with the people from Rasdorf? Oh, well, they come out every Christmas Eve because a few years back, a man made a run for the fence with his 4 to 6 year old son and the guard towers opened fire. And the father, in a last-ditch effort, threw his son up towards the fence. And this young boy was caught in the wire at the top of the fence. And the East German border troops left him there for the better part of a day. Everyone came out and photographed it very scrupulously. But that is the mentality of the opposition. And it is important to never forget that. So we have a dead man and his young son on a Christmas Eve. And the people in Rasdorf, Germany didn't forget that. And I can assure you that the soldiers serving at OP Alpha didn't forget that. Let me move forward, though. That was a very instructive part of my background and my approach to how I conducted my work. I went on from there to run counterespionage operations, offensive operations, which in regular English means double agent operations. And that is where we put somebody in front of the bad guys and let them think that they have recruited them. And our ultimate objective is to recruit the intelligence officer running that person. But that's sort of the goal or objective. We're trying to influence, see, we're running an influence operation, right? We're trying to influence and feed information to the opposition in a way that lets them think they're in control and they're calling the shots. So those offensive operations I ran for a while. I also conducted counter-espionage investigations. And in that case, I'm very happy to say that I personally am responsible for 6 foreign intelligence officers being neutralized to one degree or another. When I say neutralized, I don't mean killed. I mean turned off, stopped. 2 Poles, 2 East Germans, and 2 GRU officers. You know, just last weekend, the 9th of November, was the anniversary of the fall of the wall. And I can tell you that we had a very active, very controversial GRU case that was going on just as everything was falling apart in 89. And what's interesting is this was an agent who had been handled by the East Germans. And the East Germans handed him off to the GRU because the target he was operating against was headquarters of the United States Army Europe. And the person they had recruited to operate inside headquarters of the United States Army Europe literally had the keys to the kingdom. He could see every war plan, everything that was going on in the headquarters. What's interesting about it is, as things destabilized in East Germany, they didn't stop doing what they were doing with respect to espionage. They, in fact, increased what they were doing. And with respect to who they gave the case to, who the MFS transferred this asset to, they didn't give it to the sword and shield of the party, because the party was coming apart at the seams. Who did they give it to? They gave it to their military intelligence service, because regardless of whatever would happen to the party, to the KGB, one thing is for certain. The Soviet armed services, the Soviet military, was always going to defend Mother Russia. Right? So regardless of what happens with the KGB, the GRU, the military intelligence service of the Soviet armed forces, to one degree or another, would obviously have an interest in what was going on at headquarters, US Army Europe. So we saw an actual increase, an uptick, in what the GRU was doing. I'm proud to say that I am the last commander of the Soviet Military Liaison Mission Control Facility, which is kind of an oddball, anachronistic leftover of the end of the world, Second World War, where military liaison officers were swapped between the 4 great powers. And the Soviets had an operation in Frankfurt, Germany, and we spent an awful lot of time looking what the Soviets were doing, looking at us. And so that operation obviously folded up and wrapped up. I spent an awful lot of time doing surveillance work, commanding the Army Surveillance Detachment. We did all kinds of fun things with physical, technical, and aerial surveillance. But I say that as a qualifier. I don't have books as my colleagues do. But today I investigate and report on the operations of our government. Next week we're going to publish a report. I'll give you a preview. It's called "The U.S. Government Purges of Law Enforcement Training Materials Deemed Offensive to Muslims: Documentation and Analysis of Islamist Active Measures and Influence Operations Targeting Anti-Terrorism Training." And I bring that up because what we've been talking about, or what I've been talking about the last few minutes, are influence operations and active measures. Those activities undertaken by an opponent, both to find out what we're doing and how we're doing it, but also to influence the outcome, to affect policy, to sway thinking, to control language. Those are all objectives of our opponent, whether it was in the Cold War or whether it's today. 2 things to go away with. One is, besides reading this report when it comes out next week, I want you to think about the fact that there today is not a single United States government employee in the law enforcement and intelligence world who goes to work each morning with the mission of identifying and defeating the Islamist active measures threat against us. There's not a single government employee doing that, not one.
I used to do it.
I guess the operative part there is used to. It just doesn't happen. And what we're faced with now, and it's folks at this table, obviously, and also in the audience, who are really kind of, you know, voices in the wilderness. I'll put in a shameless plug for Diana's book. There's a character in her book by the name of Major George Racy Jordan. And Major Jordan was a fellow who went running around warning of a very grave, insidious threat to our country, and tried his very best to point out, hey, guys, there's something going on that we need to take account of. And, you know, to a certain degree, there's a bunch of Major Jordans sitting around here who are pointing at something, saying, hey, wait a minute, there's something that just isn't right. My last comment, and that is that, you know, FDR had his Harry Hopkins and his Lachlan Curry and Harry Dexter White and Alger Hiss and others, whether they were agents or fellow travelers or dupes or, you know, useful idiots or however you want to characterize them, they certainly weren't on our side. But today, in this administration, we face other folks. We face folks like Rashad Hussein, Huma Abedin, Mogaded El-Biari, Magid, and others. So that's the bridge that I'm trying to draw. So, yeah, a long time ago, I used to do stuff in the intelligence world about people who are trying to affect the outcome of things. And they had different ways of doing it. But the fundamentals, the parallels that you can draw between the active measures campaigns and activities of the former Soviet Union and its allies and what we are experiencing today with those that would influence decisions and outcomes are alarmingly parallel or aligned with each other. So it's a wonderful privilege to sit on this panel today. I'd encourage you to read our report next week, and thank you very much.
Thank you, Chris. Well, if for no other reason for having this panel, having a chance to tease this report is well worth the effort. Thank you, Chris, very much. As you've heard, our next guest is one of the last of the active measure countermeasures in the U.S. government, at least that we know of. By way of introduction, I want to just call to your attention another little book. This is one that we published at the Center for Security Policy, but it is a document that was introduced into evidence in the Holy Land Foundation trial, which probably gave us, those of us outside of government, outside of the classified domain, as clear an insight into what we are up against in terms of the Islamists' subversion within the United States as anything that's come along. This particular document, which our next speaker, Stephen Coughlin, I think introduced me to, is instructive in a number of different respects, but I just would mention it in this one regard, which I know he will address at greater length. It describes the mission of the Muslim Brotherhood in America as a kind of civilization jihad whose purpose is to destroy Western civilization from within by their hands, meaning ours, and the hands of the believers so that God's religion is made victorious over all other religions. It also helpfully identifies a number of the organizations that are aligned with that mission statement and the Muslim Brotherhood in executing it. And I just couldn't be more pleased that Steve Coughlin, who has taught me a great deal on this subject and is about to publish a new book on it as well, entitled Catastrophic Failure, is here to talk us through what's happening today, Steve, with today's totalitarian threat.
Thank you, Frank. Can I take that for a second? I just want to do something. You know, both me and my wife went to DLI in the early 80s. We were Russian language qualified. We did the crypto analysis component to that and did what you would do when you get that type of training. And it was at that time that I read this book called...
DLI being the Defense Language
Institute. Defense Language Institute, I'm sorry. And it was in that time I came across a book that came out from this publisher called Samizdat. and it was called Utopian Power, or Utopia I Vlasti. And it went into some detail about how the Soviets went after the kolkhozes, those would be the peasant farmers, the people that they said they represented, to forcefully convert them to the kolkhoz. And it was only because of Herbert Hoover that some of these people even survived, because he put together one of the largest, one of the first ever mass relief programs. But I think it's important. We talk about this. This is the document, the first document I wrote when I was in the Pentagon, that I was asked to analyze this document, and somebody leaked it. And it was within a couple months that then the assistant to the Deputy Secretary of Defense worked to get me fired. It caused a huge explosion. But I want to kind of hit what Frank just read, just to really put a hard point on here, because so I could read, you just heard him say it, the process of settlement. If you ever hear someone say they're only here to settle, and you know that somebody who represents the Muslim Brotherhood, I want you to do a hard statutory construction. When they say this, it means that, and it means nothing else. Okay? Let me see. Now I have to find it. Okay. Okay. The process of settlement is a civilization jihadist process. Let me qualify this. This was seized in a raid of an American Muslim Brotherhood entity. This was admitted into a federal court of law, okay? So as a legal matter, this is a legal fact. This is their strategy document. So when you hear them talk about by their hands, it means everybody who works with them to help them achieve this goal. The process of settlement is a civilization jihadist process with all the word means. The Ikhwan, that's the Brotherhood, must understand their work in America is kind of a grand jihad in eliminating and destroying the Western civilization from within and sabotaging its miserable house by their hands and the hands of the believers, so that it is eliminated and God's religion is made victorious over all other religions. So if you have, for example, a law professor on your staff who belongs to a Muslim Brotherhood entity, he exists for the sole purpose of doing this. And it doesn't matter what else might be said. So you know you're in trouble when you're watching, when 50 people send you a video clip of an Al Jazeera news story where there's a Muslim brother on one part of the story and a Pentagon official on another, basically alluding that you're a nut. You know, think about that. I mean, in all the time I was ever in the military, the idea of a U.S. military officer going on the foreign media to cut down a U.S. officer, that's just simply unheard of. And it's just a way of telling you, for people who think that things are business as usual and this is something on the margins, it's not. I'd like to throw out a couple things of, did you know? How did you hear this? Or did you not hear about this? For example, how many people here heard about the largest influence operation on Capitol Hill in history? Probably, but certainly within the last 50 years, where someone was convicted just about a year ago. How many people heard about that? It was an influence operation that ran for about 20 years. It was a man named Nabi Fai. He was reporting to Pakistani ISI, that's their intelligence division. And he was a prominent member and leader of one of a number of the various Muslim Brotherhood front groups that are the people who brief our national security people on the war on terror, who are by name beholden to this document that we have admitted into a federal court of law. Because my point is, it's what you don't know that's going to kill you. Starting in 2010, late in 2010, I started giving a briefing. It was given on Capitol Hill. I gave it in January 2011 to the FBI CT division. And I actually told Frank one day, you can run with this. You can take it to the bank. And that was this, that the Arab world is coming down. It's going to be a Muslim Brotherhood operation from the very beginning. Here's where they're going to fall. Here's how they're going to fall. And they're going to position it as a democracy movement. And of course, they will put those democratic movements into Rear Square because they know that's who you're going to go to. But at all times, this was a Muslim Brotherhood operation, so that at all times, you could predict every event that's happened, almost like you could put it on a calendar. And of course, the calendar wouldn't be dates, it would be event-driven. But how is it? Because for the fall of Mubarak, the Brotherhood couldn't do that. Who put the heavy diplomatic pressure on the Mubarak regime for him to sit down? Who brought military resources to bear to overthrow? switch sides on the war on terror, and nobody seems to even know or care. And the problem is, this is easily demonstrable. We knew who the people were in Libya, who we were giving aid to, because a high percentage of them we captured in Iraq. They constituted, among a couple groups of them, the largest group of foreign fighters that we encountered in Iraq. So there's so much about this stuff that is known and knowable. And the interesting thing about it is, the facts, when you decide to orient on facts, they cut one way. This is not one of those, gosh, you know, you say tomato and I say tomato. And you know, if you kind of look at this and you spin yourself three times and look sideways, you can come up with a counter argument. We know who the Muslim Brotherhood is. We have their document in America. We have their global document. And we have their policy implementation documents. We have so many of them that we've helped members of the Judiciary Committee subpoena the Holder Attorney General office to release the boxes of documents that we have. How many people know about that? Boxes. They have the checks written. So here's the thing. A couple years ago, about a year ago, maybe 18 months ago, a member of Congress gave me a letter. It was a letter that was written by Farina Akhara, who runs an organization called the Muslim Advocate. And of course, that's a Muslim Brotherhood extremely friendly, I'd say. It's clearly in the Brotherhood orbit, demanding that a number of people be fired, and some people were named by name, but also called for a purge. Let me just see here. Let me just run down. Also demanded a review of all training, a purge of all federal government training materials, ensure that personal reviews are conducted and all trainers and other government employees are promoted or demoted, and issue guidance that clearly states that you cannot talk about the Brotherhood. This is in the letter to the White House. I also got the response that was favorable. And then, you know, within a year of that letter coming out, we have from the Joint Forces Staff College the fact that the chairman called for the relief of some military officers briefing facts about the Muslim Brotherhood and terrorism. We have then Director Mueller calling it a purge when directly asked in oversight testimony. I mean, when you hear about words like mandatory retraining, that's something we kind of have associated historically with the other side. And I just would like to point out that it was this week, because people are kind of pinging me because they told me I called this, and one of the things I'd like to say, if you orient on the facts of who these people are, you can predict everything they're going to do, is that Putin is going to maneuver himself into becoming the person who's going to be recognized as the protector of Christian aspirations in the Middle East. And guess what? That just happened. If you go to the Middle East, in the Arab world, they know who's killing them. And they know who's backing the people killing them. And it ain't the Soviet Union anymore. And I think this is something that's, it's one of those things, do we really need to look at these things? So we had that letter, but you know, there was an NPR article that came out in June 2011. It was completely erroneous, basically saying things about what was briefed at a presentation that actually were not briefed by people who eventually lost their jobs for doing things like putting out bad information. And then it said, and there's also this one of those guys, he's going to be briefing the CIA later this summer. Well, that person was, of course, me. And this is when we first saw the pattern come down. The pattern was that came out, a trending left publication came out with something, followed, and you could argue coordinated, a CARE document demanding an investigation. CARE, Council on American Islamic Relations, a known element of the Muslim Brotherhood, known to be formed out of Hamas. Hamas is still a registered on the FTO, Foreign Terrorist Organizations list as a terrorist organization. Of course, Article 2 of the Hamas Covenant says they are the Muslim Brotherhood. So, I mean, so we can win that argument on the facts. We always do. But CARE coming out demanding that there be an investigation at this training stop. And soon enough, a publication called Wired Magazine started writing articles, identifying me and saying things, and I would show up, I would show up at, oh, by the way, that CIA, that CIA training was canceled. In fact, the CIA had their countering violent extremism mission canceled, and it was transferred over to DHS, who took that mission on. Okay. But then what happened is I was going to go brief at the FBI. It had been briefing there continuously, and all of a sudden, that got stopped. And then all of a sudden, he wrote some articles about me briefing the information operations course, and all of a sudden, that got stopped. He wrote some articles. And each one of them, you had a Wired magazine stating things which are brazenly erroneous, followed by a CARE demand, and they came back to back. They were sometimes in the same part of the day. And you know, sometimes if something comes out late at night and the other thing comes out late at night, you know, you start to understand what's going on. But the other part of it was when the person from the CIA was calling, or when the person from the DOD was calling, or when the person from the FBI calling said they had to cancel it out, every one of them said, you know, we'd like to say we're going to resolve this, but this is coming from the White House. Okay. And of course, I have an attorney, and they have the names of the people who did that, and you know, that'll be something that's memorialized somewhere. But so we had this going on. You had Lieutenant Colonel Dooley lose his job. Now, I have a personal background on that, so I'm not going to go too far in that, but a lot of what caused Lieutenant Colonel Dooley to face problems was the fact that we confronted one of the people in his class when he said some things which were clearly alarming. In fact, the rest of the class was alarmed at what was said when it turned out that this colonel who was in the class wasn't even a member of the class. I'll stop there. So where does that leave us today? What does it mean when we see this penetration that nobody knows who the OIC is? Because I will tell you, in our circle, we know who the OIC
is. You might say what it is.
I was going to. In our little circle, we know it's the Organization of Islamic Conference. Okay? And we know by varying degrees what it is and what they stand for. But if you take one step out of this office and go to the office next door, nobody knows about it. That would be like fighting the Cold War and not knowing who the Warsaw Pact was. Serious. Okay? And why is that important? Because on July 15, 2011, our Secretary of State met with the head of the OIC in Turkey and agreed to help pass a UN resolution called 1618, which was known to give effect to the OIC's 10-year plan to make defamation of Islam a punishable crime through UN legislation, okay, that they were going to then work to implement. At the same time this is happening, you had the CRCL, Civil Rights, Civil Liberties Division of DHS, working with members of the Brotherhood to create what they were calling the Combating Violent Extremism Narrative. And you know, I have to seriously plug Judicial Watch, because the things we were saying you should expect to see, that I was able to frame pretty tightly. Eventually, Judicial Watch documents came out, Freedom of Information Act documents came out, that nailed it hard to the ground. And I'll tell you why that's important. Because we could project what was going to happen just by following their doctrine and what they were doing with documents that would later come out that said that's exactly what they're doing, and it's completely predictable because they are what they purport to be. The number one objective of the Muslim Brotherhood in America is to get you to try to understand world events without understanding the events driving them and think, turn it into a political science narrative and think that that's an answer. All the time these events are going on. So we have the State Department getting it passed. It was actually the U.S. State Department that managed to get it passed through the UN in December 2011. You have the CRCL at DHS implementing it, and under direct testimony to the chairman of the Subcommittee on the Constitution, the number two person at the Justice Department, Assistant Perez at the time, was directly asked twice if he would forswear ever doing something as staggeringly unconstitutional as subordinating the First Amendment of the Constitution to Islamic concepts of slander under the name of Islamophobia, okay? And twice, under direct questioning, he refused to answer. So how many people were aware of any of those three? And how many people were aware of all of them, all three of them happening concurrently? Except people who've heard me brief, let me say. He's helped edit my book, he knows. But how nailed down is that? Am I like putting tinfoil on my head to say that, or can we nail it down hard? We can use FOUO documents from Judicial Watch to nail this down. There's no place for cover. And yet it's not even being reported. So I think we have a very serious situation. And I want to end because I'd like to thank the Judicial Watch people because they make what I do. They basically confirm what I say 2 years ago when those documents come out. They came out with some documents this summer on Al-Waqi. They came out with some documents on Hassan. I will tell you, when Major Hassan struck, the FBI came up to me and they asked, how is it possible that you were briefing how terrorism would happen in this country? And that Major Hassan's briefing, where he declared his hostility, matched your brief on 19 slides, word for word. And my answer was, I was telling you why they're going to do this. And he was telling you why he's going to act doing this. They follow Islamic law. How do we know this? They say so. So here's the point. I got into it with some people at the FBI because I said I wanted to see those emails to Major Hassan. Major Hassan sent to Al-Waqi, and they said, there's no relevance here. It'll be in my book. But what I just recently did was I analyzed them according to what they specifically said was the basis of their decision making and showed that everything about those correspondence had to do with an orientation to Islamic law. And if they had just accepted that what they said drove their decision making actually did and pretend it was true, just for due diligence purposes. Even if they say 95% of it says it's wrong, but just to satisfy crackpots like Steve Coughlin, we'll do the due diligence and map it to Islamic law. They would have found that that was an open declaration of hostility. He pledged his allegiance to not only Al-Qaeda, but Al-Qaeda is run by Al-Waqi, and acted. So I think that I wanted to try to tie in this pervasive encroachment. Most of these people are not spies. You cannot arrest the Muslim Brotherhood for conspiracy because they write these things in English. And they publish them. And you can go on Amazon and get them. Serious. So the question becomes, we see this major influence operation going on. We see that a huge 20-year influence operation hitting both sides of the aisle went on. And it didn't even make the news. And I would like people to start to become prepared when the Middle East completely collapses around our feet. There were people who warned about it with extreme precision, okay, with specificity. And if you read my book, you'll find out some of it. But when these people are shocked, it will never be because they didn't have the information. It will be because they put their ideological drivers ahead of facts that otherwise couldn't have pointed to any other direction. Thank you.
Steve, thank you. We're going to open it up to questions. I just want to make one sort of summary observation here. What you've seen, I think very well demonstrated here, is the parallels between the influence operations of the communists during the Cold War. We've had names named, some of them. The documentation provided of their character, their success, their impact in things like having the Japanese go to war with the United States instead of Russia, having Yalta formalize arrangements that persisted for decades to the great detriment of millions and millions of people. You've had names named in an upcoming report by Judicial Watch of Islamist influence operators inside the government of the United States, executing on a strategy that has been documented and introduced into evidence by the federal government itself in court. We've touched on a little bit, though perhaps in Q&A we might do a bit more of it, some of the influence operations that these folks, the Islamists, the Muslim Brotherhood, the Pakistani ISI, and others have succeeded in waging against us. One is the one that that is particularly, I think, dear to those of us who are trying to raise the alarm about this. which is our freedom of speech. And as Steve mentioned, one of the influence operations was aimed at the Istanbul process shutting it down. It actually, I think, dates back to March of 2009 when the newly arrived Obama administration started down this road, co-sponsoring with the government of Egypt on behalf of the Organization of Islamic Cooperation, language that basically set up this idea that slander against Islam must not be permitted, which translates into all kinds of things. I would argue, among other things, perhaps some of the behavior that led up to Benghazi. And certainly the argument that came out of Benghazi, which was that it was all a video that blasphemed or slandered or otherwise offended Muslims. Does this sound familiar? Anyway, the point is that I think what we are confronting here at this moment in time is the direct legacy of a period that Diana has documented really began in earnest 80 years ago tomorrow, or technically Sunday morning, I guess. But it is upon us now, and it's incredibly important that we be alive to its present manifestations, and we be bringing to bear the counter capabilities against these kinds of active measures, influence operations, subversion, civilization, jihad, whatever you choose to call it, in our own time. With that, if anybody has a question and you would identify yourself, I think we have a mic. Do we have a mic here?
Tom Trento.
Yep. Stand by.
You got a mic? Tom Trento. Yeah, Tom Trento. Chris, when you call up President Obama and ask for some paperwork, what kind of response does the administration, what's their first response?
The most transparent administration in history is notorious for double talk. The first response is either wait or no, and then we have to go back and exercise under the law all the administrative remedies that are available to us. And once those are exhausted, then we go to court. And we've gone to court a lot with this administration. You know, the Bush administration was characterized as being secretive, and they were, but they told you that right up front. They said, we're not going to give you stuff because we're involved in two wars and we're just not going to discuss it. And people may not have liked that, but at least all the cards are on the table and you sort of understood it. This operation, this administration is insidious because they talk a game and they flout and promote and have a slick marketing angle to how they're being transparent and open. And it's a lie. It's just that simple.
Yes, sir. Our host.
Hey, Frank, thanks for this presentation.
Tom Fitton of Judicial Watch.
Forgive me if you covered this already. Could you talk a little bit more, if you haven't already, about the alliance between the transnational left and the relationship with the most retrograde of movements, and I think people would be surprised to learn how they're more than happy, despite Putin's protestations to the contrary, to advance their agenda.
We'd like to take that on. Steve? Oh.
I think there's a quote from Carlos the Jackal that came out a number of years ago that said only an alliance between Islamist and Marxist will bring down the United States. And in fact, I make it a common theme. I think that today's left really expresses itself through what I call the postmodern narrative. Other people call it something different, but what I mean by that is this relativist view of the society that's kind of merged with this left-wing political agenda that causes things to merge, so that at almost every place you see it, really, the Brotherhood's subversion of America isn't based on Brotherhood doctrine. Brotherhood doctrine causes them to subvert, but what they do it is on the back of this postmodern, politically correct narrative. It's in manipulating that and insinuating their whole doctrine into that. So I think that I'm one of those people who thinks that if you're going to go after care, you better have enough. You better have either a defense or hold position for the ACLU, because they're working hand in glove. I think when you get down to the philosophical underpinnings of the left and Islam, they're people. How could the Brotherhood work with the hard left? And I think if people understood the philosophical underpinnings of these two, they'd understand that they have an awful lot in common. And it's not nearly as far out as you would think. They both have a totalitarian view. And of course, they'll fight it out afterwards, but that's no different than Stalin fighting with his compadres. Only Hitler was someone who realized that he came to power with the brown shirts and had to purge himself with the black shirts. You know, there's something kind of interesting about that. But I think that you really have to understand that their penetration into our systems is through this politically correct narrative, which has specific postmodern outcomes. So they created the word Islamophobia to fit right next to homophobia. Okay, but Islamophobia is a term that's under the active control of the Organization of Islamic Conference. And just for the point of this, making this point, the OIC represents every Islamic country at the head of state level. It's an intergovernmental organization, not an NGO. So that when the OIC maintains positive control of the term Islamophobia for use in our jurisdiction, people should understand that to be the direct injection of hostile foreign law into the United States as against the First Amendment of the Constitution. But there's an active alliance.
Could I add to that? First of all, I'm probably the little person up here about the Islamic threat. But I've learned a lot listening, and I've learned a lot reading recently about this. And I see the parallels all over the place. And one of them directly stemming from what you just said, sir, is this self-induced aphasia, astigmatism about the nature of the threat. Now, to what degree this is just stupidity, and to what degree it is conscious complicity, is an interesting question. And I'm this is a legal forum here, this building, this office. And there is a Supreme Court decision called the Schneiderman decision, which was handed down in 1943, which said, in essence, Schneiderman was a leading member of the Communist Party. And the essence of that decision was that just because somebody is a member of the Communist Party doesn't mean anything. After all, a person like Schneiderman might have joined the Communist Party because he wanted to help poor people, or he wanted to plant flowers on the George Washington Parkway. We don't know why he joined the Communist Party. So, therefore, mere membership in the Communist Party is not a problem. This was the doctrine that allowed the massive infusion of communists into our government in the war. That just because somebody's a communist doesn't mean that necessarily he or she is doing anything wrong. That same doctrine, and you probably know far better than I, is now applied to Muslims. And there are guidelines for the FBI and others saying, just because somebody is a member of a Muslim terrorist organization doesn't mean that he or she is a Muslim terrorist. That person may be a member just because he or she believes in soup kitchens. So you cannot therefore exclude such a person just because of that membership. Now, to wrap this up very briefly, if something, Diana has heard me do this before. If you look at the guidelines, and this is well before 9/11. These are the guidelines for a visa application on the State Department website, and I see some people nodding in the audience. These are the questions that would be asked if you went to Riyadh in Saudi Arabia and applied for a visa to come to the United States, as terrorists did in 9/11. They would have had to answer these questions. Do you seek to enter the United States to engage in export control violations, subversive or terrorist activities, or any other unlawful purpose? Are you a member or representative of a terrorist organization? Have you ever participated in persecutions directed by the Nazi government of Germany? How old are these people? And or have you ever participated in genocide? So I'm in Riyadh, Saudi Arabia, and I'm going through this, and I'm going through this list. Do I want to do export control violations? Yep, yep, yes. And there's a yet, check yes or no. And I said, I am a member of Al-Qaeda. Yeah, I said, yes, I've checked that. Did I participate in persecutions directed by the Nazi government of Germany or genocide? Well, I was just a kid, but yeah, I did a little bit. So I go, yes, yes, yes. And then he says, and I'm not kidding, this is what it says, well, a yes answer does not automatically signify, you know, it does say this. For a visa, if you answer yes, you may be required to personally appear before a consular officer. So it's like, yes, I'm a Nazi, you know, genocide committing member of Al-Qaeda. Well, then we need to talk. And so this is the mindset that was inculcated in World War II toward communists that is now transposed to the Islamists.
I think Diana wants to say something too, but let me just make one point. Steve said it's kind of incredible perhaps that the Islamists would want to be associated with the left. I get that all day. I mean, this is useful idiots galore. What's harder to justify or conceive of even really is how a group that is dominated by feminists and homosexuals and Jews and artists and songwriters and all kinds of people who don't have a God or who have changed their God. I mean, people who generally do not fare well under Sharia. How they could possibly make common cause. And it speaks to Steve's point that it is evidently of such surpassing importance in their political philosophy that they can make common cause with enemies of our country that it trumps even self-preservation. It's unbelievable. But thank you for the question, Tom. It's a critical one.
Thank you. I just had two quick comments. Yes, all of those things are true, but I think the important underlying similarity between Islam and communism is that both are collectivist creeds, both are totalitarian. While communism obviously does not have a god, its acolytes certainly have a religious fervor for it, and they both have an attitude toward the ideology, either communism or Islam, as being the final form, the inevitable form. And I just wanted to point out that in 1920, when Bertram Russell went to the Soviet Union and came out to enlighten the world because he talked about a conspiracy of concealment was abroad in terms of trying to hide the terrible things that were going on, he brought news of the communist revolution to Europe in terms of Islam so that they would understand it. Just namely, Bolshevism combines the characteristics of the French Revolution, which is the real expression of the left, with those of the rise of Islam, and he went on to describe that. So people who understand these things understand the basis is collectivist, is utopian, which means dictatorial. And then the second point would be, all we really have to do is look to Europe to understand how it works, how the union of Muslim parties and far-left parties unite to freeze out the more classically liberal parties, the parties who have an attachment to their heritage and don't want to be changed either by the left or by Sharia. So you see these things across Europe already in action, and they're very instructive if again, we look.
Chris,
no.
Yes, sir.
Hi. My name is Yaroslav Martinyuk. I'm a retired sociologist and a great admirer of both Stanton Evans and Diana West's works. I'd like to take this opportunity to point out that this month, the Ukrainian community worldwide is celebrating the, is commemorating the the 80th anniversary of the terror, genocide, famine in Ukraine. And in fact, on December 4th, there is going to be a ceremony dedicating a monument to the victims of the so-called Holodomor, which is the Ukrainian equivalent, translates as death by starvation. I would like to underscore the genocidal nature of this atrocious act, because almost exclusively, only with the exception of Kazakhs, the victims of the Holodomor were Ukrainians. Even the ones living in Russia, the fertile Kuban region, it was majority predominantly Ukrainian-speaking ethnic Ukrainians. So almost all of the victims were Ukrainian. Now, before I ask the question, a couple of words about the word genocide. This was a term invented by a Polish-Jewish historian, Raphael Lemkin. He did this in the late 30s, and when he invented this term, coined this term, he actually had the Ukrainian genocide in mind. However, after the war, when the UN discussed who to include as a genocide, the Ukrainians were excluded because the Soviet Union protested. Now, that even today there is a dispute among historians whether to consider the Ukrainian terror famine a genocide. So my question is two-part. First of all, when did you first hear of the Ukrainian famine genocide? Where and how did you discover this fact? Because for over half a century, this was a secret. And then secondly, how would you classify this Ukrainian famine? Would you consider it a genocide like the Holocaust, like the Armenian genocide, the Rwanda genocide, etc.?
Sure. I would say that I first studied it in the period of the last several years when I was working on American Betrayal. And of course, the light for English-speaking people would be Robert Conquest, whose book on, I believe, I'm trying to remember what year it finally came out. It was 76. And yes, according to this term, gen meaning family, and if we have a Ukrainian, such an overwhelming number of Ukrainians, it would seem to me to qualify as a genocide. I didn't know that the word was coined in to describe that atrocity.
First of all, the easy answer is yes, it was genocide. No question about it. I first learned about it in the 1950s. It's what I read, Assignment in Utopia by Eugene Lyons, a book written in the 30s. Which I then read when I was a student in college. And that's when I first encountered the name of Walter Duranty also, who is featured in that discussion by Gene Lyons. I would go further and say that if you look at the Nuremberg trials, in which the Nazis were correctly accused of every form of atrocity, the Soviets had committed every one of those same atrocities, and in larger numbers because they were in power longer. That was deliberately excluded from the discussion. A good example of this, and it wasn't the Ukrainians, although the Ukrainians were the most numerous victims by far, were the Poles. And the Katyn Forest Massacre, which our government knew, this is where 15,000 to 20,000 Polish officers were murdered and buried in the Katyn Forest in Russia. Our government knew that the Soviets had done this. an American intelligence officer reported, who'd examined the bodies, that they were victims of the Soviets. He reported this in 1945. It was suppressed. The report was suppressed. Hearings were held about this in a Congress in 1952. The executive section committee hearings, which went into the suppression of this report, was itself suppressed. You cannot get that executive session report to this day, because I tried and you can't. So the cover-up of the genocide committed by the Soviets against the Ukrainian people, and Eugene Lyons makes that very plain, was part and parcel of a systematic genocide committed by the Soviet government over a period of decades, and a systematic denial and concealment and complicity in this deception by our own government.
Could I ask you to specifically add one thing, which may be the one you want to add, maybe it's not. In your book, you talk at some length about not simply documents being unavailable, but documents being disappeared from various archives and libraries and official papers and so on. Could you talk a little bit about that as evidence of covering up?
Sure, although actually that would be Stan's subject, because generally he was doing the shoe leather work and we would find. I did want to make one more further comment about, Stan mentioned the Eugene Lyons book, Assignment in Utopia. And actually, I was quite struck by the discussion of how to cover the Ukraine famine that is gone through in excruciating detail, in not that it's boring, but that it's so uncomfortable, in Lyons' book. And I actually dwell on it in my own, because it shows from the inside a press setup, a press decision to collude with one another as a small community of correspondents in Moscow to cover up an event of this magnitude. And what happened was, there was an outlier, a man named Gareth Jones, who was Welshman, who had been Lloyd George's secretary. He came to this area. He went off on his own. He saw the famine. He saw the effects. He talked to various diplomats. He came back out. He went to Germany, held a press conference. He told the world about the famine. And imagine all the cables coming from New York and elsewhere in London and so on to their correspondents in Moscow saying, what's going on? What's going on? Is there a famine? And that's when you see the very famous Walter Duranty report, and that's where you see the very odious phrase, to make an omelet, you need to break eggs. And it was pertaining to the Ukraine famine. And Lyons, who was part of this collusion, they actually meet with the Soviet censor Umansky and set up how to soft sell what Jones put out there and how to kind of undercut him and what to tell their editors back in New York, and then they have kind of a party with hors d'oeuvres and vodka, and it's a grotesque scene, and Lyons, whom I greatly admire for not only his skills but his honesty, because he was part of it, and he left this mindset, he left this culture, and he wrote about it, he admitted it, and it's very illuminating how it is done, but it was definitely pertaining to Ukraine. And that's part of the reason we did not know about it. And that's why you often hear calls to revoke Walter Duranty's Pulitzer.
Amen to that. Would you just say a word about your efforts to uncover some of the documents and how they've gone missing?
Yes, it's hard. It's so widespread, it's a little hard to summarize. Basically, there has been a systematic weeding of the records of the things we're talking about in our own archives and in records that were assembled by others, the Dies Committee, the various other committees that looked into these matters. And I discovered this in all innocence in doing my book about Joe McCarthy, because I found out there was a report filed in the summer of 1946 by a man named Samuel Klaus, who was an official of the State Department, writing about the security problem in the State Department of that day. I talk about this in the McCarthy book and also in the new book a little bit. And he listed certain elements of the security situation in our State Department. And the findings of the State Department Security Office that there were 20 Soviet agents in the State Department at that time, and a variety of other suspects. This report became a subject of controversy in 1950 under McCarthy, compelling the Tidings Committee to ask the State Department for the report. They got it. It was delivered to the Tidings Committee. That report should be in the archives right up the street here at 7th and Penn of the Congressional branch of the archives, because that's where the Tidings Committee archives now repose. I went through those archives twice, every document. This document is not there. The transmittal letter is there saying, here's the document. The document is gone. The document should also be available in College Park, which is where the State Department archives are, under the name of Samuel Klaus. I went to College Park and there pulled the file on Samuel Klaus. There's an index to his papers. There is this report listed. The report is missing there. It was withdrawn from the archives in 1993. Almost half a century after it was written, which was the early days of the Clinton administration. I found the report. I have the report because I found it in the FBI. And it was impossible in that day to get documents away from the FBI. I'm not sure that is still true. The FBI files are now themselves being diminished. They're disappearing like the Cheshire Cat. And this is something that I'd like to discuss with you, sir, at your leisure, because I'm trying to find out what is happening to these files. That's just one example of scores.
Frank, just a quick note on files. We asked for the FBI file of Ted Kennedy when he died, and there's one page in particular from 1961 when he went on a Latin American tour with a Professor Planck from Harvard. And the entire page is blanked out. We fought them over the particular page to have them release it. And sure enough, once you get down, we fought for 6 months in court over this. We had Department of Justice attorneys lying to the court that the page was classified. They could not possibly release it. It was classified secret. What they were trying to do was engage in legacy preservation, not classification. Because what it says is that when Kennedy arrived in Bogota, Colombia, the very first person he wanted to meet and that he insisted on meeting with the ambassador was Lachlan Curry.
I don't want to get into specifics about people lying today, because there's people who I work with on the Hill who have been directly involved with being directly lied to by members of the FBI and DHS and sometimes an oversight. That's very clear. And to bring the whole documentation thing, just to round out what I was talking about, there's a guy, I think his name is El Barassi, for reasons I won't go into. He was pulled over and they had a material witness warrant on him that gave him the ability to go search his house. His house was in Northern Virginia, and in his house they found a basement. That's not abnormal, but in the basement they found a sub-basement, and for this part of the country that is very abnormal. And in that sub-basement, they found the entire archives of the Muslim Brotherhood in America, including this document. And I am convinced that some of the things that the Judge Solis at the Holy Land Foundation case realized when he was trying this case was that he was up against something very big. So he did two terribly unusual things for a judge, and he allowed himself to get slapped on the hands for it later, but never apologized. One, he created a list of unindicted co-conspirators that made it clear who these 260 organizations and people were that were immediately implicated. And the other thing he did was he posted, and I think they're still on the West Texas Court of Appeals or the District Court webpage, all the documents that were admitted into evidence. That was only 1/10 of the documents that they actually captured, and they only translated 1/3 of those. So what we have is a situation where you had members in oversight specifically ask for those documents to Holder, who said he would look into it. These are the documents that were turned over to the defense. These are documents that were already partially admitted into evidence that they have to this day refused to turn over. And there are, they had truckloads of these documents. And these are documents that would nail these people to the ground. There's even the documents we have already create no daylight. So why is it that where we have people who, a side version of this, we have tapes of the FBI bugging these people in Philadelphia in the early 90s because they were known to belong to a terrorist organization that in the later 90s were declared terrorist organizations here, Hamas. So we're in a situation right now where I can be coming to under legal trouble for actually citing documents that the FBI collected, that the Justice Department used in a federal court of law to convict these people. But these documents, I don't know if they're disappeared yet, but they are made completely unavailable. And I don't think it's because we know that they won't say what's going to happen. It's because there's just, there'll be no daylight.
Well, we've gotten to the 2 o'clock hour. It's flown by for me, I hope for you as well, with some extraordinary insights into not only a epical moment in history that we mark on this occasion, but its relevance to today. We're doing it with people who are actively in the fight to expose this information, to make it known to the public, which is entitled to know about it, and otherwise to try to ensure that we learn the lessons from the covered up genocides and the subversive, seditious activity of the past, because it's happening today and certainly will, I think, in the future if it is condoned or tolerated, as we seem to be intent on doing. I want to thank the various extraordinary speakers, Diana West, Stan Evans, Chris Farrell, and Steve Coughlin, not just for what they've done here today, because that's important, and I hope through the miracle of the internet we'll be reaching a large audience, but for what you all do and have done and will do, I'm quite sure, on this count in the future. One other book that is being promoted from the side by Tom Trento, who helped co-author it, is a book that Diana and Steve Coughlin and I collaborated on, among others. Among others, Michael Del Rosso in the room, are the reports of the Team B2 called Sharia, the Threat to America, Claire Lopez as well. So thank you. I commend all of these books to you. Required reading all. Get to it quickly, please, because we're marking this date, but how many more of these anniversaries we have to note as free people may well depend on how well we learn these lessons today. So thank you all very much, especially to Judicial Watch for hosting us and for the very kind attention you've given us as well. Thank you.